So now on numerical methods, I like to continue on computer arithmetics. So we started our session on computer arithmetics by looking at integers. Okay, so we saw the set of integers, and the set of integers was relevant in defining the floating point numbers. So the floating point numbers are is now the focus of this session and the next one. We defined the floating point numbers, so a subset of real numbers, a discrete set representing certain real numbers. And since we look at rounding today, we will see that it defines some kind of equivalence classes. And the definition was somewhat split, yeah, depending on certain regions, you know, say the numbers around zero and the numbers that stay away from zero. So the first set that we defined was the set of normalized floating point numbers. So the normalized floating point numbers, you recall here our little drawing, were the numbers that somewhat stay away from zero. So there was something here. And then we had a certain scale. So the scale is growing. You know? And then there was within this scale some equidistribution of the numbers. These were the normalized numbers. And another definition was the denormalized numbers. So the denormalized numbers were now the missing gap around zero. So we had here zero, and now zero belongs to the set. There was here not in this set the numbers that are already in the other set, and then it was some kind of equidistribution within this set. And we observed that there were actually two versions of zero. There was plus zero and minus zero, okay? Because we have here this encoding of the sign multiplied with zero if z equals zero. And then we spotted that there was another encoding for special cases. And these special cases included plus or minus infinity. Okay. So, and now the question is, what happens if we perform arithmetic operations on this set? Yeah. Of course, we take two numbers from this set. We plug these two numbers into some mathematical formula. And then the result not necessarily is in this set. Yeah? It could be that the result, the mathematical result, is in between numbers, yeah, that are in this set. So since I want to have the result represented again as a floating point number, I need some rounding of the result. Okay, so the implementation of this standard, so IEEE 754, is such that it uses exact rounding of the result. So when you plug in two numbers from this set, you can be sure that the result that is given to you is the nearest representative of this set to the exact result. So it is the nearest representation in the set of floating point numbers that you receive. Yeah? So the result of a single atomic operation is rounded to the next number in the set. So, well, there is a small important thing here. It is this guarantee only holds for a single operation. So if we perform multiple operations, one after the other, the rounding errors accumulate and they become larger. And this is an important topic, loss of significance, which we will look at in the next session. So we have this rounding. So let's define the rounding. So we have here the set of floating point numbers. So the set of floating point numbers consisting here of the normalized floating point numbers and the denormalized floating point numbers. Yeah, so the union of the two and the special values minus infinity and plus infinity. So I'm considering these values as part of the set F. And then I define the rounding operation. And the rounding operation is such that we choose the nearest representative within this set to some x. Yeah? So float of x. So this is my rounded number. X is here from the set of real numbers, is such that the distance of the two corresponds to the minimum distance from the nearest representative. Actually, if you're just in between, yeah, it could be that this definition is ambiguous here, because there are two possible solutions here, round up or round down. So, and I'm not specifying here what is done in that cases. And actually, this is an interesting subtle point, because if you always round up, it gives you a bias. For example, all positive numbers will be slightly larger. And if you do this in large computations, it can actually make a difference that you are always rounding up. And for that reason, this standard also specifies different versions of rounding. For example, alternate rounding up or rounding down. Yeah? So if the number is in between, it's sometimes rounded up and sometimes rounded down. Of course, but this only holds for the limit case where you're just in the middle of the interval. Okay, so we have some rounding, and let me draw again now our set F. Okay, how did our set F look like? So we had the denormalized ones. So let's maybe make this screen here. So this is here the zero, the plus zero, or the minus zero. And then we have a certain interval here and this equidistribution. So you see I'm using p equals 2. Yeah. So I have four numbers here. And then we have the normalized one. So actually this guy here already belongs to the normalized ones. So this is the blue ones here. So and now the intervals become larger. Maybe something like this. Okay, and the same on the other side here. So this is the blue set. And then we have plus and minus infinity. And let's have a look again at plus and minus infinity. So if we have the normalized numbers, the largest possible number is double max value, okay, which is c equals 2 to the power of p minus 1, and e equals e max minus 1. Okay, so e max minus 1 is the largest possible value for e, and 2 to the power of p minus 1 is the largest possible value for c. So the next number would be c increment by 1. So c is 2 to the power of p. So this here is actually 1 plus 1. This is 2. So the next number is then 2 to the e max. Okay, that's just the next number, which I cannot represent in this set. And now let's have a look at infinity. And you see that infinity is exactly e equals e max and c equals zero. So actually, I'm talking about plus infinity, though it is that one. Yeah, so the other one is minus infinity. So plus and minus infinity are just the next numbers that we cannot represent. So we can actually think of these as being just the next numbers on our discretization. So they are just these guys here. Okay, so this guy here is plus infinity. This guy here is minus infinity. So while plus and minus infinities are, say, special symbols, special cases like an error, something has happened, in this interpretation, you can think of them as being just numbers. And the funny thing is that now we can implement in an arithmetic operation a rounding to infinity. So, let me first state what I mean. We round the result. Yeah. So, exact rounding in this IEEE 754 standard means that I have some input numbers in my set F, and then I'm considering a mathematical function, a G of x1 and xn. So this here is just the true mathematical function. So no guarantee that the result is in the set F, but I assume that now the result is well defined. So I assume here the result is well defined. So that means I assume that the result is in R. So we assume G of the arguments is in R. So we get some result. So it's not the square root of a negative number or something like that. And then we can define rounding. So the computer implementation, G tilde. So this is the computer implementation under our standard here. So this is the computer implementation of this function. Yeah. So when you apply exponential function in the computer, then it is guaranteed that it is the exact result rounded to the next floating point numbers. So that's the definition of applying this function on the floating point numbers. Okay. And we can interpret plus and minus infinity as numbers, and we have some rounding to infinity. So the numbers minus infinity and plus infinity are, if we look at results, yeah, just interpreted to as numbers. So now the next question is, what happens if plus or minus infinity are an argument? Yeah. So I could say 1 divided by plus infinity. So what's that? So or I could ask plus infinity minus infinity. So plus infinity plus minus infinity. What's that? So if you look here at this picture, then if I interpret these as numbers, you see this number here is just the positive value of that number here. So you could think that plus infinity plus minus infinity equals 0, yeah? Because they are just the same numbers, 2 to the power of e max and minus 2 to the power of e max. Well, that's not the case. If plus and minus infinity are the arguments of the function, then the result depends a little bit on what is the function. But if we consider results, there is some rounding to infinity. The same happens for the special value, not a number. This is the result when the operation is not well defined. Yeah, 0 divided by 0, infinity divided by infinity. And actually also plus infinity plus minus infinity will actually lead to this result, not a number, because he cannot be sure what that should be. We will have a look at this. Okay, so we already did this exercise, and I will repeat it here. Let's skip that and let's just make the remark again that we have some rounding to infinity. So before I start the next session, let's have a computer session where we explore a little bit what's happening here. So the picture we have to have in mind now is this here. We have this certain set of floating point numbers, and I would like to explore a little bit the properties of this set now in a computer experiment. So I start from scratch. So I create a new class. Let's call this floating point arithmetic experiments. Yeah, so we already did this, but we can start over. I need some main method where I can execute a little bit of code. Yeah? So a question which we already had is, how can we actually, for example, find the smallest possible non-zero value? So which is in our picture, this guy here. Or how can we find the smallest value that is larger than one? Yeah, so which is this guy here. And you can actually find these by making numbers smaller and compare the number to either zero or one. So maybe let's start with the first one and have a small title here. So this is the smallest positive non-zero number. Okay, so I define it, say, let's call this number tiny. I start with one as a guess. Yeah? And then while tiny divided by two is larger than zero, I make tiny smaller. And let's print this out. So let's call it tiny. And let's print this number. Okay, so what happens now if you divide this number by two again? Okay. So if you divide this number by two again, so I get tiny half. I get zero. So tiny is now actually here in our picture, this guy. Yeah. So if I'm dividing it by two, actually I'm small and the result is rounded to zero. Okay. So, but now what happens if you multiply this again with two? So let's divide this by two and then multiply again with two. It stays, of course, zero. Huh? So you see that dividing by two rounds to zero. And then, of course, zero multiplied with two is still zero. Okay, so you see that if you do multiple operations, yeah, so now I'm dividing by two and I'm multiplying by two. If you do multiple operations, then the rounding error suddenly has an effect and I get a larger error, okay? The result should be tiny, but I get a different number. It's rounded to the wrong result. Okay, so that was already the feature that we have exact rounding. But if you do multiple operations, the rounding error can become larger. So next experiment, maybe I draw a little line here so that our printout is a bit nicer. And next experiment is find x such that 1 plus x half is equal to 1. And I would like to find x larger than 0, the smallest one. The smallest number, such that if I, the largest one in this case. So let's do it like that. Okay, so I would like to find the smallest x, such that if I add x to 1, it is not rounded to 1. So sure, if I take a very small number, it is rounded to 1. So if we go back to our picture, so now I'm here. So now I'm here. So if we go back to our picture and we have a number here. So if the number is too close to 1, then the number will be rounded to 1. So let's find the smallest number x such that we 1 plus x is distinguished from 1. So I start with 1 as a guess. Sure, 1 plus 1 is 2, and he should distinguish that. So that's the guess. And I call him this epsilon, or just eps. And I do it in a similar way. So I make epsilon smaller. So while while 1 plus epsilon is larger than 1, he should make it smaller. And let's print now this number. Okay, let's print this number. So the number eps we have found here is not the x, because I have made it smaller, and then the test here was false. So actually I'm stopping at the point where 1 plus eps is equal to 1. So it's not larger than 1. So I have to make this description here precise. So I'm looking here for eps such that 1 plus eps is equal to 1, and 1 plus 2 times eps is larger than 1. Okay, that's the number which I'm calculating here. So let's try this, okay? Let's try, what is 1 plus eps? Okay, so 1 plus eps is equal to 1. So I can test, is 1 plus eps larger than 1. I can just do a test. 1 plus eps is larger than 1. And he will print that this is false. So 1 plus eps is not larger than 1. So what happens if I calculate 1 plus 2 times eps? So 1 plus 2 times eps. So 1 plus 2 times eps is some number. And you see, this here is the bit that has actually now changed. And this here is the smallest difference he can see. Okay, so eps is truly this number. 1 plus eps is equals to 1, and 1 plus 2 eps is larger than 1. So this epsilon here is the machine precision. Okay, so this 10 to the minus 16 here is now in our picture. If this here is 1, so we assume E min equals to minus one. Right? Let me see definition one. Let me see definition one. So it is between E min. So I have E min plus one is equal to zero. All right, so E min minus one, right. Yep, I'm confused because there's a small typo. Yes, it's E min minus one because, sorry, there is a small typo here on the script and we have to fix this. This here is an E min plus one. Yeah, so, because if you look in definition three, yeah, the exponent is E min plus one. So if you assume that E min is minus one, then actually the flip over point between denormalized numbers and normalized numbers would be just one. Okay, so then the machine precision, yeah, in that case is here exactly this in our picture, this difference here of the point where I'm rounding to one or to the next value larger than one. So in other terms, it is the relative rounding error. Okay, so it's actually the relative error that we have looked at in this exercise. So I have this exercise here, yeah, show that the relative rounding error is exactly delta, where delta is smaller than 2 to the power of minus p plus 1. So, and 2 to the power of p is the denominator, c divided by 2 to the power of p. So it's 2 to the power of minus p is the smallest, is the gap size, yeah, is the size of the interval. So you see 2 to the power of minus p plus 1 is exactly our epsilon. So it's exactly here this interval. So in this exercise, this here is actually our epsilon, the epsilon that we calculated in this program. So let's continue exploring a little bit our numbers. So next exercise, we have here this rounding error for the small numbers. Yeah, so I have rounding to zero. I have rounding to one. So actually, what happens if we take the largest number? So this guy here is actually double max value. Okay, so what is happening there? So let's explore this in the next experiment. So let's draw a small line here so our output is nice and have a small headline. So what I'm doing, so we look at the behavior around the double max value. So let's define the max value. So we can ask the double class for this. Okay, and let's print this number. So max double. So let's print this number. So what is that number? Okay, so that's a huge number. No? So actually this is the largest exponent we can get. So the largest exponent is 1023. So that is 2 to the power of 1023. And then multiplied with 2 would be the next number. So to the power of 1024 would be the next number, which is then infinity. So this guy is actually 2 minus 2 to the power of minus p, so minus a small number, times 2 to the power of the largest possible exponent. Okay, that's actually the number in this picture. So what happens if we add something large to this? So what happens if I add another guy to this, if I take it twice? Okay. So max double plus max double. So what's happening then? Okay, then I get infinity. So what's happening here is I have an arithmetic operation. It is a function of these two numbers. The sum of this number is somewhere there. Huh? The sum of the result of the number is somewhere here. And then the result is rounded back to infinity. What happens if we take a large number, but not such large number? So I define, say, a big step. And now, so what's the gap size here between these two guys here? What's the gap size between these two guys? What's this gap? So actually the scale where I am on is 2 to the power of 10,023, okay? Because that's actually now the exponent that is valid here for this region. So these regions are all the numbers here multiplied with 2 to the power of e, and the largest exponent is 1023. And then the gap size is actually the smallest distance between two numbers is actually 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So the gap is this guy, and then multiplied with 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So it's p is 52. It's this guy minus 52. So that's the size of the gap. Yeah. I call it big step because it is a big number. Yeah. It's still a big number. Okay. And now I take just half the size of the step. Well, let's take maybe a little bit less. I take a little bit less than half the size of this step. And I add this number to half or less than half the step, okay? So to be precise, yeah? So this is 0.4949 times the step. Or maybe I'm just defining here the step. Yeah, that's maybe a bit nicer. And then I can, this is the step. And then I can here write max double plus 0.49 times the step. Okay, so now I would like to know what's actually this guy. Okay, so. And you see, it's rounded back to the same number, okay? It's, again, the maximum double number. So let's take now a little bit more. I take, say, 0.5 of the step. Oops, 0.5 of the step, and let's run the program again. And you see, this is too much. Yeah. So now I'm rounded to infinity. So you see that here for infinity, actually, if I'm right in between, if I'm just here in between, I will be rounded to infinity. Okay, so we know now a little bit what is the behavior around infinity. There is a largest number, and if we become larger than that number. It can happen that we are rounded back to the number, or we round to infinity. Maybe we should also look a little bit at what is infinity doing. So behavior of infinity. So actually, you know how to create infinity. Yeah? So it's now just max double plus something which is too large, but you can also just ask him. So please give me infinity. Yeah, so there's positive infinity. So I can print this. Oops. Okay, so maybe I make again this nice little line here so that our output is a bit nicer. Yeah? And you can print this. Okay, here we print infinity. So actually, what happens if you take twice infinity? Okay, of course, twice infinity is just infinity. Okay, so now back to this question. We also have minus infinity. So let's call this here maybe negative infinity. So I can ask him for this. And well, to be a bit more consistent in my program, let's call this here positive infinity. So since infinity is actually, well, just a number, yeah, it is 2 to the power of e max in my system, I could be tempted to think that plus infinity plus minus infinity is just zero, okay? Okay, so let's have a look. What is positive infinity plus negative infinity? What's that? So I can also just print negative infinity here. So if you want to see it, so we have more output. So let's have a look. Yeah, so I have a positive infinity and a negative infinity. And if I take the sum, he will print me not a number. Okay, and that's reasonable because actually the plus infinity and the negative infinity could be the result of a function. And the function had very large results, but we don't know how large the result is. For example, the result could be actually a number which is here, and it's rounded back to infinity, and the number that is here, and it's rounded back to infinity. And you see, this one is much larger on the positive side, as this one here is smaller on the negative side. So the difference would be something different from zero. Okay, so he is not sure what is the difference of the two numbers. So of course, he will print me not a number, which is a good thing. Okay, he's warning me something went wrong on the way of your calculation. But you can calculate a little bit with this infinity. So what is, for example, 1 divided by infinity? So 1 divided by positive infinity, let's just try that one. So 1 divided by infinity is 0. Okay. So what is 1 divided by minus infinity? So the negative infinity. So 1 divided by negative infinity is, whoops, minus 0. So we see actually we have the two different zeros. Okay. And Also, what is 1 divided by 0? Is that a well-defined operation? Yeah, or is it maybe not a number? So if you do that, 1 divided by 0, okay, 1 divided by 0 is plus infinity. Yeah? So certain calculations, yeah, are reasonably defined and they operate in this set. Yeah? Okay, so next question is, we see that there are two different zeros. Yeah? And sometimes it's nice to see that there is a minus zero or a plus zero, because if you have a convergence result where numbers become smaller and smaller, then you can judge by this if you have converged from right or from left. Yeah? It makes a difference. You either converge to plus zero or you converge to minus zero. So let's look a little bit at the behavior of plus and minus zero. So let's draw again this nice line here. So we have cleaner output. And let's define plus zero. So I can maybe just now use this little trick of using double positive infinity, 1 divided by double positive infinity and negative zero. You can also define it differently. So let's call it minus zero. You can also define it differently. For example, here we had this little experiment that we made this smaller and smaller. Let me try. What happens if I start here with a minus one and I converge from the other side? Okay, then you get the tiniest negative. So the largest negative number, yeah, non-zero. And if you divide it by two, you get minus zero. Okay, so you get the other zero. So you see that you can use this to distinguish convergence from left or convergence from right to a zero. So I have now a plus or a minus zero here. Let's just print this. So I print out the two. Yeah, so we have the two different numbers. And of course, the question is, are they now different? Huh? Are they different? So let's have a test. Is plus zero equal to minus zero? Okay, so I do a Boolean test. Is plus zero equal to minus zero? Is that the case? Oops. Let's run our program. Oh, there is a typo. Okay, so let's run our program. Another typo. Okay, so let's have a look. Yeah. Yes, this is true. Yeah. So he considers the two numbers as equal, but they have a different representation, and sometimes it's nice to know that they have this different representation. Okay, so of course, last question maybe, what is now 1 divided by minus 0? What is 1 divided by minus 0? So this is 1.0 divided by minus 0, and you maybe guess it will be minus infinity. Yeah, 1 divided by minus 0 is minus infinity, so he goes to the other side. Okay, so maybe I could continue this for a very long time. We already have seen not a number here, yeah, plus infinity, minus infinity. If you take the sum, you get not a number, so have maybe a last small printout behavior related to not a number. Well, when do you get not a number? Well, you get not a number if it is not well defined. For example, the square root of minus one will give me this. Yeah. So I can have here square root of minus one will give me this. So you get not a number. And actually, this is a nice thing. It depends. Some programming languages implement this differently. For example, if you have minus zero, the logarithm of minus zero is sometimes minus infinity. Sometimes it is not a number. Okay, you could also maybe ask of square root of minus zero. What is he doing? This, yeah, and square root of minus zero gives us a minus zero. That's actually a thing which I don't like so much, yeah, because a minus zero is something that has converged from the left, yeah, and maybe I should consider to have another number here. Okay. Let's have a small break here. That's the session on these floating point numbers and rounding. And in the next session, I like to look actually here at machine precision, and that this actually will cause us big problems.